Good morning from me as well. It's lovely to be here and to see you all and to join in worship of our Lord and our God this morning. Sometimes we wonder how we should come. We come rushing, perhaps. Sometimes we come in a contemplative state. Sometimes we're a little bit down because of circumstances that have happened during the past week. Sometimes we've got things to celebrate. But Paul tells us this: when you come in your relationships with one another, have this mindset, the same as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, didn't consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God our Father. We're going to sing a song based on those words of at the name of Jesus, and I invite you to stand and sing as we sing this hymn together.
Every tongue confess Him, King of glory now.
take your seats. We're going to come to prayer and reflect on those words and echo them again as we pray to our Lord. Let's pray. Lord God, our Father, our King, the one whom we worship, we come to your throne now and we give you our praise. We bring you our worship and we say, Lord, you are the God above every other God. You are the King of kings and Lord of lords. And we acknowledge you now, just as we heard those words from Paul. We give you the rightful place in our lives and in our experience, in our days and in this church this morning. Lord, may you accept our praise. May they be accepted because they're coming from hearts which are true to you, that acknowledge you as their Lord and Saviour in a personal way. Father, thank you that you've brought us here today, that you've given us your word, which we can look through and learn from and apply to our lives. Even though some of it is so many years old, it still has a message now that is relevant. So, Lord, take this time, whatever happens during this period that we've set aside for you, may it be something that is a blessing to us and of glory to you. Accept our praise and our worship this morning for Christ's sake. Amen. We're going to have our readings now, and I understand it's a husband and wife team who are going to share our readings this morning with you.
The first reading's from the Old Testament in 2 Kings chapter 18, and it's the summary, the story of Hezekiah, who was king of Judah. In the third year of Hoshea, son of Elah, king of Israel, Hezekiah, son of Ahaz, king of Judah, began to reign. He was 25 years old when he became king, and he reigned in Jerusalem for 29 years. His mother's name was Abijah, daughter of Zechariah. And he did what was right in the eyes of the Lord, just as his father David had done. He removed the high places, smashed the sacred stones, and cut down the Asherah poles. He broke into pieces the bronze snake Moses had made. For up to that time, the Israelites had been burning incense to it. It was called the Nehushtan. Hezekiah trusted the Lord, the God of Israel. There was no one like him among all the kings of Judah, either before him or after him. He held fast to the Lord and did not stop following him. He kept the commands of the Lord had given Moses, and the Lord was with him. He was successful in whatever he undertook. He rebelled against the kings of Assyria and did not serve him. From watchtower to fortified city, he defeated the Philistines as far as Gaza and its territory.
The second reading is from John 3, the first 21 verses. Jesus teaches Nicodemus. Now there was a Pharisee, a man named Nicodemus, who was a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God. For no one could perform the signs you are doing if God were not with him. Jesus replied, Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again. How can someone be born again when they are old? Nicodemus asked. Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born. Jesus answered, Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised by my saying, You must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. How can this be? Nicodemus asked. You are Israel's teacher, said Jesus, and you do not understand these things? Very truly I tell you, we speak of what we know and we testify to what we have seen. But still you people do not accept our testimony. I have spoken to you of earthly things and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak of heavenly things? No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people loved darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God.
And God will add his blessing to those readings. Thank you, Richard and Joy. Going to continue our worship now with the opportunity to bring our offerings to the Lord. Shall we pray? Father, we bring you these offerings out of the bounty of which you've given us in the first place. Lord, as we return these gifts to you, we ask that you will bless them, increase their value beyond their monetary value, May they be used for the extension of your kingdom and by in wisdom as they are applied to the causes they have been given. Lord, bless this offering and bless the giver. For Christ's sake. Amen. We're going to sing one more song in a moment before I bring some words and thoughts that I've prepared for today. And during the singing of that song, we're going to invite the children to go and do their own activities rather than have to listen to me. If that means I'm speaking to myself after that, so be it. But the opportunity's there. So shall we just pray for the children before they go? Father, we thank you for the blessing that the youngsters here are to us. We thank you for the joy they bring. Lord, as they occupy themselves with their own activities in the next few minutes, Lord, just may that time be blessed for them too. And may they find pleasure in one another's company and in your presence. For Christ's sake. Amen. So our next song is My Hope is Built on Nothing Less. And I hope that you'll be able to join in with this as we stand to sing together.
Within the veil.
Thank you. I don't know if you want to take a seat in the front rather than seeing my better side. I don't know what you made of the reading from 2 Kings 18 that Richard shared with us. Have you heard it before? Good. Did you realise, if you hadn't heard it before, that it was in the Bible? And if you did know that it was in the Bible, had you read it or heard it read recently? Is it fresh in your memory? It's a little bit unusual, I'd imagine, to have those verses read. And generally, I think it's fair to say that the part of the Bible it comes from, the Old Testament, is probably not as well known as the New Testament, except that is perhaps for some of the Psalms or particular stories like the creation, the flood, David and Goliath, and that sort of thing. And whilst that may be a rather sweeping generalisation, I think it's more or less true for many people. In fact, came across this story that seems to support my suggestion. Apparently at a school there was a standing teacher in front of the class, and part of that task for the day was to do religious education. The teacher asked, "Who knocked down the walls of Jericho?" A rather sheepish response was offered. Well, it wasn't me, sir. So the teacher went to the head teacher and asked the same question. Who knocked down the walls of Jericho? I'm not sure, came with a rather apologetic reply, but I'll come back to you with an answer, the head teacher hurriedly added to cover up their ignorance. When the teacher had gone, the head teacher called for their secretary and dictated a letter to be sent immediately to the education department asking, "Who knocked down the walls of Jericho?" A number of weeks later, there was a reply. I can't be certain it was from the current Secretary of State for Education, Bridget Phillipson, or not, but the reply said, "You just get the wall rebuilt and we'll make sure someone pays for it." Well, of course, there is some poetic license in that story. I wouldn't want you to quote that as evidence of anything in particular at the moment that's happening in schools, not least because the education secretary nowadays wouldn't sign a blank check like that. Nonetheless, there is an inkling of truth, I think, in it. Outside of the church, I'm sure there are plenty of stories in the Bible which, even though we might think are well known, others just wouldn't know existed, let alone be able to answer questions. And if you're not a Christian, I suppose that's understandable. After all, the Old Testament can be seen in various ways. Whilst the Bible itself may be a bestseller, I'm sure if you asked a librarian, they would vouch for the fact that the book doesn't get checked out from the library to borrow very often, especially not on the strength of the Old Testament. And you may think it's just a history lesson. After all, it does record the early story of the Jewish nation. Or you may consider it close to folklore, just a series of old stories gathered together. And there are many sayings that are commonplace that actually have their origin in the Bible somewhere. And you may, alternatively, even view the book as irrelevant, dry, boring, uninspiring. And there are plenty of lists and numbers and names to be found in those 39 books, which I admit it's difficult to get excited about. And I have to confess, too, that there have been times in my Christian life when any of those opinions, if not all of them, have been opinions I've held. But as I've reluctantly admitted to maturing in years, I have begun to realise just how significant the events that are recorded can be, and that there are lessons that we can learn from history, that these stories have relevance for us today. And that if you look them closely at what is being told, there can be real excitement and inspiration in the events that are recorded. And while I'm in the mode for confession, I have to say I haven't come to this conclusion alone. I found it very helpful to listen to Premier Radio, and one particular series of studies I like and I have the podcast for is Insight for Living with Charles Swindoll. If you can get past the American accent, it's really good teaching that he brings. And he's shared various times about Old Testament passages. And amongst these studies, I remember that he looked at Kings and Chronicles, two books you might expect to be dull and boring. But I'm drawing on a thought that he shared from 2 Kings chapter 18 and the accounts of the early reign of King Hezekiah. But can I just go back a little bit before we come to Hezekiah and set the context of what was going on? Go back to the time when the Israelites were going around the desert trying to find the promised land, being led by Moses. And if you go back to Numbers and chapter 21, you'll find the people of Israel there in what then was not an unfamiliar mood. They were complaining. We'll leave aside whether or not they had justification for that and just pick up the story as we read from chapter 21 and verse 4. From Mount Hor, they set out by the way to the Red Sea to go around the land of Edom. But the people became impatient on the way. And the people spoke against God and against Moses and said, "Why have you brought us out of Egypt to die in the desert? There's no bread, there's no water, and we have this detestable, miserable food." Just as an aside, that detestable, miserable food was manna, food especially provided by God. Pick up the reading again. Then the Lord sent venomous snakes among them. They bit the people, and many Israelites died. The people came to Moses and said, "We sinned when we spoke against the Lord and against you. Pray that the Lord will take the snakes away from us." So Moses prayed for the people. The Lord said to Moses, "Make a snake and put it on a pole. Anyone who is bitten can look at it and live." So Moses made a bronze snake and put it on a pole. Then when anyone was bitten by a snake and looked at the bronze snake, he lived, and the Israelites moved on. What an incredible story. Who needs a National Health Service when you've got a snake on a pole? I don't know how recently, if ever, you've been to Southend Hospital, but there is a mosaic on the tower block of a snake on the pole, and that draws on this very story. It's also the passage that Jesus referred to, that Joy read to us, when he was talking to Nicodemus. And in those verses 14 and 15, we read, "Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life." But let's not get ahead of ourselves. We're still looking at the original Moses episode. God was obliged to deal severely with that rebellious people, but he showed mercy and compassion by providing a way out if they decided to take him at his word. Now, doesn't that have echoes of something relevant and exciting and interesting for us today? God, through Moses, gave instructions and offered the way for anyone who had been bitten by a snake to be healed. The snake that Moses made was the symbol of God's goodness. It was lifted up, and all the suffering person had to do was make an effort to look at it Note, this was God's plan and God's provision. There were no magical words that Moses had to chant like some early day Paul Daniels. There was no power miraculously emanating from the bronze snake like an early Indiana Jones movie. No one had to touch it, hold it, swear by it, or believe in it. They simply had to make the effort to look. I believe in that simple story, there's a relevant and forthright message for us in the church today. It's all too easy to look for the latest gimmick to get people's attention and persuade them to listen. But really, all we have to do, all that needs to be emphasized in a very literal way, is that people need to look to Jesus. In the words of the gospel writer, we have to lift up the Son of Man so that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. Just as the Israelites were given the opportunity to be healed, just like God had a plan all those years ago, just the same as God provided a solution then, in the same way, the people nowadays, our community, where we live, the people we interact with, must be given the opportunity to see Jesus, who is God's plan and solution today. All that is required is that people look to him. How you do that, individually and corporately, is between you and God. But that's what we must center upon, lifting Jesus high so that he is seen. Well, that's the earlier story and how it may apply today. The history that comes with the history of Hezekiah, if you follow. So let's look at King Hezekiah now. Here was a young man, just 25 years old, who had inherited the throne of his father Ahaz. King Ahaz had ruled for 16 years, if you want to check back to 2 Kings 16, and had led the people of Israel away from Jehovah and into idol worship. So they were now very well versed in how to worship statues, how to set up Asherah poles, and knew what to do at high places. But somehow, somewhere along the line, and that's another separate and exciting story, God preserved his law, and Hezekiah proved to remain faithful to it. His first actions as a king were to remove the high places, to smash the sacred stones, cut down the Asherah poles. Great! At last, a king of Judah who could rightly be seen and recognized as a true descendant of God, of David, someone who followed God, someone who was prepared to stand up for the right, and more importantly, to do something about it as well. Perhaps this is our first challenge from the passage this morning. When we consider our life generally, our various habits, good and bad, even in our Christian life, if that applies to you, what would you answer if I asked the question, are you involved in idol worship? Of course, I can almost hear you saying, of course not, don't worship idols. But are you sure? Deep down, what is it that motivates you? What gets you going? Gives your life true meaning and purpose? Whether or not you're a Christian, it's sometimes good to take stock and to think about your life, to ensure that you have the right perspective and focus, that it's not got out of balance. So just think for a moment. And perhaps it's not such a ridiculous question after all. Maybe there's something in your personal life, a worry or concern about the future, your health, your family, and that's clouded your view of Jesus just now, you'll know what it is. Something else has your full attention, and it's either distracting your vision or blotting out your sight of God. Just think of a total eclipse. The sun's light is blocked by a smaller object, the moon. But the eclipse doesn't make the sun smaller or the moon bigger, does it? It's just simply that the moon takes up all the space of what you can see. It's in your sight line and you can't see past it. Is this your experience at the moment? Is something in your sight blocking your view of God? Like Hezekiah, you need to remove that high place and put God back where he belongs. Or maybe you set up a sacred stone that you're determined to achieve, perhaps at work, that next job, the next promotion, your salary review, and it's become so absorbing that it needs to be smashed to allow you to see Jesus again. Or maybe it's a hobby or a pastime, an interest or a leisure activity that's become so all-consuming that it takes precedence over your time with God. It's become your idol. Something so important that church time, prayer time, Bible reading time, time with other Christians has become no time at all. Or even it may be that you have not yet thought about nor yet responded to the claims that God has on your life. And so without realizing it, you've erected other Asherah poles to worship. More and better possessions, longer and better holidays, richer and more glamorous clothes. And these things are the only thing that you can see is worthwhile focusing on in your life. If any of that is true for you, and you're now wanting to correct your view and get a better, clearer perspective on your life, then like King Hezekiah, you must remove, smash, or cut down that which is stopping you from following the one true God. But listen to what I'm saying. I'm not saying that home, family, jobs, health, hobbies, and so on are unimportant. All of them have their place. But I am saying that this sort of drastic, extreme action is necessary if these other things have become the be-all and end-all of your life, and there's no room left for God. Yes, getting rid of the trappings of the false gods and other religions was a tremendous and spectacular first step for the king, as it can be for us. But Hezekiah didn't leave it there. He also went along and broke into pieces, we read, the bronze snake that Moses had made. Can you imagine how the Judah Heritage Society reacted to that, if it existed? Now, hold on a minute, King Hezekiah. You're going a bit too far here. Of course we know there's only one true God. And yes, we agree that all these idols and things need to be got rid of. But the bronze snake? It's part of our heritage. It was made under the instruction of God himself, Jehovah. It's our link to him. You can't go getting fanatical in destroying that bronze snake too. But that's exactly what Hezekiah did. He saw the corrupting influence that this relic had become. He perceived the undue significance that this bit of history had been now for the people. They even worshipped it, we read. This image they were bringing incense to, going so far as to give it the name Nehushtan. And so it grew in prominence and fame throughout the kingdom. And isn't that just so like us today? Don't we so easily corrupt and twist, change the things that God has given us, the good things, and then they become the things we worship and long for. Maybe that we have come a bit more attached to a memento or a keepsake, a piece of jewellery, a book, even a crucifix or a family Bible. And now it's become a good luck charm or a talisman. Maybe it's a relationship that we're involved in to the detriment of our walk with God. Even a friendship that came out of your going to church. And now you just can't get by without referring to that person or being with that person when you go to church. Maybe it's even the wrong stress we put on church attendance or working in a church organisation or fulfilling a duty in the church. It's become so all-consuming that in fact Jesus is lost in the hurly-burly of it all. None of these things are wrong in themselves. Indeed, most, if not all, have their place in the context of a full, healthy Christian disciple's life. But just as the bronze snake was kept and eventually became revered so that it was the centerpiece of worship, so our devotion, our loyalty and commitment can be misdirected. Now we look to the thing, the person, the position or the duty, rather than looking at the author and reason for it. Instead of that keepsake reminding you of a time when God spoke to you or did a special work in your life, that very symbol of goodness to you has become the essential thing that you must keep with you. Otherwise, you fear you won't hear God speaking to you again. Instead of that friendship, even with a fellow Christian, which grew out of your shared love for Jesus, instead of that supporting your development as a Christian, you find that that person is the only reason you go to church. Instead of fulfilling a role that the Lord has called you to in life, doing it with enthusiasm and love, as if to the Lord himself, now it's become an obligation, a duty, that God-given motivation has gone. It may have been a good thing once, but now it stands in the way of your closer walk with God. If you can hear echoes of this in your experience, can I encourage you to have nothing more to do with that Nehushtan? Make now the time to put things right and begin again with God. Resolve today to join with the many others here and throughout the world in singing your praise to Jesus. So this is the message I bring this morning to you for you to consider. However you've come, whatever your circumstances, do you have to make that first step and see that it is Jesus who's lifted up for you to look at, so that your future may be clear and full of purpose? Or do you have to get rid of something that has taken the place of God, something that needs to be cut down, smashed or cleared away, so that Jesus can find his rightful place in your life? Or is there a Nehushtan in your life? Something that may once have had a connection to your spiritual life, perhaps even to your conversion, and you know it's now become greater than the Lord and Saviour to whom it first directed you. Has a thing, a place, a person, or an activity taken the rightful position that Jesus should have in your life? Or is it Jesus, who's the King, the one you worship? Is it Jesus who came as a servant to be lifted up and give his life on a cross for you and for me? Is it Jesus, the Son of God, our Saviour and our Lord? Can we consider this as we prepare for communion, as we sing the words of the song? such love, pure as the whitest snow. As we come to this table, let's be sure that we come to worship him, not the bread, not the wine. And as we sit together, let's reflect, remember those disciples on the road to Emmaus, just after the crucifixion. They were met by somebody they were kept from recognising. And they talked about what had happened and how all of that led into the story of Jesus. But still they didn't recognize their companion. And as they came to their final destination, they invited Jesus to stay with them. And when he was at the table with them, he took bread and gave thanks and broke it and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him. And he disappeared from their sight. They turned to one another and said, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked to us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" In the words that have been spoken today, those things that we've sung, the readings that we've heard, I hope your heart has been burning too. And now you will see Jesus at this table. Come to this table not because you must, but because you may. Not because you are strong, but because you are weak. Come not because any goodness of your own gives you a right to come, but because you need mercy and help. Come because you love the Lord a little and would like to love him more. Come because he loved you and gave himself for you. Come and meet the risen Christ, for we are his body. Let's pray. Eternal God and Father, we offer you our praise and thanksgiving for the creation of your world in all its richness and glory, for your gracious work of redemption, for your calling of men and women to share in the work of salvation, for Jesus Christ our Lord, for his life and ministry, his words and actions, his humanity. We thank you for raising him to life again and exalting him so that we might call him Lord. We thank you for the gift of your Holy Spirit present in your people in this world, for the fellowship of your church, and for all the means of grace and hope of glory. Living God, fill us with your Spirit, that as we share this bread and this wine, we may feed on the body and blood of Jesus and be empowered for service in your world. Accept our prayers in the name of Jesus, the light of the world and the light of your people. Amen. When we break this bread, is it not a means of sharing in the body of Christ? Because there is one body. We, though many, are one body, for it is one loaf of which we all partake. Please take and eat the bread as it is served to you, as your own recognition of Jesus Christ and his work in your life. In the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant, sealed by my blood. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me. Please retain the cup so that we can drink together. Drink this and remember that Christ's blood was shed for you, and be thankful. Like us just turn to spend a few moments in intercessory prayer, praying for one another, praying for the work here in the church, and just bringing into our prayer time those who may not be here in body but are with us in spirit. So let us bow our heads one more time and pray together. Father, we thank you for this time around the table this morning. Thank you for the community that this brings to us, the sense of oneness with one another and with you. May it be something that is treasured always, that is honoured above other things, and directs us to you, our Saviour and our Lord. We take this opportunity to pray for the work here at Friars in particular, and for the people who are involved in the church. We thank you for, as we've already prayed, for those children who are part of the fellowship here too, and ask for your blessing upon them. We pray that they will grow in their knowledge of you, that they will be nurtured and encouraged and inspired by being part of this fellowship and knowing you as their Lord. We pray for the connection that the church here has with the school. Thank you, Lord, that there is this opportunity to share in bringing what we believe into that fellowship, into that school there, through assemblies and such like. Lord, bless this work, and may it be fruitful. We pray too for the activities outside of Sunday that engage with the children and youth of this area. Thank you for the people responsible for those activities. Give them strength, we pray, to continue their work. Give them purpose and a clear direction that you will be the focus of all their activities, even when they're playing games and doing crafts. Thank you, Lord, for the various other activities during the week. The work of the church that is maybe going unseen amongst those who are not well, amongst those who are housebound. Father, we pray too for this community and the influence we can have as a church for those who are unemployed and for those who are employed. We pray for those who are grieving. We pray for those who are rejoicing. We share in their grief. We share in their joy. And Lord, bless that time in just a few weeks' time when there's going to be this stay of fasting and prayer. However we choose to participate in that day, Lord, may it be a blessing. And may you be raised up as a result. Lord, bless the search for this church for a new pastor. And bring the right person here to lead your people. Lord, there are many other things we could pray, and they're just in this next few moments of silence. We bring them to you in our hearts and minds. The things that are on each of our individual hearts. The things we need to share with you. Even perhaps the challenges of what has been said this morning. Help us in these moments to be honest before you. And to conclude this time of prayer together, we share that prayer that you taught your disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We're going to finish with one final song, and it's a song of hope, inspiration, and change. Hear the call of the kingdom. Thank you. final blessing in the words from Paul's letter to the Colossians. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace. And be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, songs and spiritual songs and words, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Your blessing. Amen.